morning, my brothers and sisters. It's so good to see all of you today. The Lord is worthy to be praised. Can we say amen to that? If we can we turn to our neighbor, to our right and left, and say, God is the God of second chances. Can we say that together? Okay, turn to you. God is the God of second chances. Amen and amen. Well, let us pray, and we will begin our confession of faith and praise today. Let's pray. Glorious and loving and sovereign, Abba, Heavenly Father God, we thank you so much for bringing us to your house, your church, where you are our shepherd, where your word is our authority. Oh Lord, we do not take lightly the gathering of your body, that everyone is needed for our growth, Lord, in you. We pray today as we seek through your word what it truly means to give your body a second chance. A lot of times, Father, forgive us for just giving our first time, our first chance. You are the God of a second time. And Lord, today, as we look into your word, as we sense the prophet's desires for your divided people, that you might make us more one, you might show us what the church is, the very body and blood of Christ, Lord. We thank you, Father, that we're two or more gathered in your name. Father, that we can truly picture you, truly know you fuller than if we were just on our own or just by those, Lord, we desire to be with. I pray, Father, you break down the walls that may divide us today, and Lord, through our lunch and sharing today, that you will have many brothers and sisters come around the table of fellowship, not just with food, Lord, that will fill our stomachs, oh God, just for a few hours, but Lord, with the food of your word, the very food of and the bread that comes from you, oh Lord, from your Son. So today, would you feed us, Lord, through your word so we can feed one another. We thank you so much for the honor to be part of this body, this Bethany family. I pray each soul that has walked in this place, whether, Lord, we've been here for many years or those who are here for a first time, may not leave here without having met you, experienced being part of you through one another, having heard the life-giving message of your Son, of his love for them, and that, Father, they will have a soft and tender heart to hear you, to open their hearts and their eyes towards you, and that you might spring forth obedience from faith out of joy. We thank you so much for the gospel that doesn't change yesterday, today, and forever, as the center of this body. And Lord, may we continue to guard the gospel and the entrustment you have given us to this body. We thank you so much, Lord, for the privilege to worship you. Would you fill us now as we confess our faith and bring you the praises due to your name, O Lord. It will be more than just sound and music, but true worship to you, O Lord. We thank you. Would you look into our hearts above all else? We thank you. We worship you in Jesus' glorious, powerful, resurrected name we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Let us all stand if we are able and confess our faith together with the Apostles' Creed today. Let's all confess together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again and ascended into heaven, where he sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the holy universal church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen and amen.
Good morning, church. How are we this morning? Good? Didn't hear from many of you. How are we this morning? Okay, good. That makes me feel better. Thank you. So before we go into worship today, let's just prepare our hearts to experience and worship our living God.
Lord, I offer my days to you. sing my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Lord, I offer you my Lord, I offer my life to you, everything I've been through. Use it for your glory, Lord, I offer my days to you, lifting my praise to you as a pleasing sacrifice. Lord, I offer you my life. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. There is no one like you, there is none besides you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And holy, there is no one like you, there is none besides you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
As we sing this next part, let's make it the prayer of our hearts that we would build our life on Jesus and nothing else. Because nothing else is worth building on. Everything else is like shifting sands. It says in the word that Christ is the firm foundation. He is the cornerstone that'll never fail. Let's make this the prayer and the anthem of our hearts this morning. Continue our worship with our tithes and offerings. Pray for the tithes and offerings. Lord, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for your goodness, your faithfulness, your the evidence of who you are in this building, Lord, your church. It's not a building. It's not a denomination. We as your people are your bride. That's what you say in your word, Lord. We thank you for all the people you brought here this morning, for all our brothers and sisters, for our newcomers. Would you be glorified, Lord? What little we bring to the altar, we bring in faith, knowing you've called us to give back what you've sown in us, Lord. Lord, we know it's not about the money. Your word says the roads in heaven are paved with gold. So, Lord, we know that it's about the heart, and that's what you care about. And so, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your goodness and your faithfulness to us, Lord. As we continue our worship, Lord, would you give us rest in you, Jesus? That we'd find peace in your promises, Lord. That we find peace in your presence, in your character, who you are, Lord. Your word says you are good. You are faithful. You are faithful to your people. We pray that you'd be satisfied in our continued worship this morning. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen, amen. Praise the Lord. Can we give an applause for the Lord's grace and the Lord's servants? Praise the Lord. Let's give an applause for any newcomers today. Thank God for bringing our new friends today. If you're new here, I'd love to meet you after service as well as our servant leaders. So thank you so much for taking the time to come and be a part of us today. I just have a few announcements before we look to the word of the Lord today. And the first is, I want to thank you last week for all those who joined our vision meeting and also donated blood. And just thank you so much for being part of this family and investing in the kingdom here together as the Lord's church, as brother prayed, the Lord's bride. Can we say amen to that? As you may have known, our youth group had their restoration summer retreat, just this past week. And so we have a short recap video, just about a minute. I wanted to show all of you, because many of our college brothers and sisters really invested, and our teachers as well, invested in this retreat. So praise God for that. Let's just reminisce of God's grace and his blessing, especially on our next generation, and give thanks to God just through this short video. Let's give an applause for the Lord's grace. Thank you so much for all the college shepherds, the teachers. You've been so exemplifying of the servanthood of Jesus Christ. And we pray in the winter, hopefully, will be another retreat for our youth so we can invest in this next generation. Praise God. Today, I just have an important announcement. After service, you might have seen some of the signs outside. We're doing a lunch and sharing today. And so I know the title is pretty general, but that's about it. That's what we're going to do, okay? And we will do this for the next 3 weeks. So, you know, you got to eat, right? So don't go out. Don't fast. I dare to say that right in front of this pulpit. But please stay. And we're going to have lunch. And we do this so that we can foster and nurture deeper Christ-centered brother and sister relationships with one another. Because many of you, I've noticed, I only see you maybe like 10 minutes after service on Sunday. And I pray that you can make a little time to stay. And we did split this into brothers and sisters. Sisters and those with children as well can be in our fellowship room here. And right after service, our brothers can be in the corner room. Okay, so let's go and make yourself available. Open your heart, eat, and pray together, and just develop friendships with one another. That's what church is about. Can we say amen to that? Yeah, we're not just all kind of private individuals just coming together, but we're one family, and we really want to open our life and our heart and just get to know what's going on in your life and pray for you and help you in your walk with the Lord. So for the next 3 weeks, can you commit to that? I'm going to. So I hope you will put in 2 feet too, as I put in 2 feet. And you can come and just make yourself available, make yourself brother and sister in the Lord, to nourish that brotherly family relationship. It's a burden, holy burden, that many of us have felt through our family retreat. And as when we say family, I mean not just married couples with kids, but the family here, family of God. So you are all family to us. So let's nurture those relationships for the next 3 weeks, okay? Which leads me to another announcement. Today at 2 p.m. is our all-gen worship service. If you haven't come yet, please stop by. It's been such a blessing to unite all the generations and the languages of our church. Pastor Joshua Jung is such an eccentric man of God. Pastor Cho and so many other servants as well. Thank you so much for building this service. So if you're around at 2 as well, when we finish our lunch and sharing, please just come in here again and have another hour of worship. What better way to spend our Lord's Day? And this Friday, we have another opportunity. We can foster these deeper Christ-centered relationships. This Friday is our Kogi and Games Fellowship, mainly for our post-grads and our college friends. So if you're a post-grad in college, before you go off to college or start your colleges locally here, this Friday at Brother JP and Maria's Hospitality and Generosity, we're going to gather, and I'm not going to prepare a deep Bible study, I promise. I'm not going to do that usually. Just the fellowship to open your life and your heart and around good food, and to bless many of you before you go off to a school locally or remotely by distance. So we pray for you, especially our college and post-grad family. So please make time this Friday at 6 p.m., okay? Also, next week is pretty busy. On Saturday, so after Friday, Saturday, we have a church-wide spring cleaning. So let's all be good stewards of this wonderful facility, that it belongs to the Lord, and we will clean the whole church as best as we can. And that'll start at 7 a.m. in the gym. I believe there will be directions where we can go to clean. And next Sunday, sadly, but just for a few, right? But sadly, I did hear that it is the last, until another break, we can see our college, a few of our college family brothers and sisters before some of them go off to schools far away. And so next week, we're going to have a time of just blessing all of our college family. If you're staying around here locally, if you're going off by distance, to just be able to pray for you and bless you as you matriculate into your classes. And hopefully you can find, if those go by distance, to find a good church, a good pastor. And when break time comes, come back here. And we're always here for you as the Bethany family. So we'll always be in our hearts, as especially our college family. Next Sunday as well, I'm so excited to inaugurate one new covenant partner, our sister Mija Lee, who couldn't be here with us today, but next week we will inaugurate her. And I look forward to the following Sunday, where we will restart our covenant partner, new family orientation. So I really encourage everyone, if you haven't made your official commitment or pledge to the Lord, or more so, the Lord's commitment and pledge to you. Can we say amen to that? And his covenant on you. Please do so. I believe it's a good next step for everyone from college, if you've matriculated here into our congregation, to express that love for the Lord and his church. So I look forward to that in the next 2 weeks. So please pray and think about that, okay? Next Sunday as well is a special guest speaker in our second Korean service. So Pastor Im Hyun-soo 목사님, Pastor Hyun-soo Lim, and many of you know him as the pastor who was imprisoned in North Korea for some time, but by God's grace was freed. So he will be here. If you do understand Korean and you have facility in Korean, I do encourage you to go to the second service to hear him. And so if you do have that facility in Korean, please do so, and please feel free to go and hear this wonderful man of God. I have a final announcement, and that is I want to request a special prayer for our infant to pre-K pastor. His name is Pastor Isaiah. I'm sure many of you have seen him. He's really thin, very good looking, but he is our infant to pre-K pastor. But right now, actually, he is in Korea. And this request was made public, is that he has had some health issues, and they found that possibly something might be going on with his liver. And so he's getting a very thorough exam in Korea in the next few weeks. And so before we look to God's word, I thought we would lift up our pastor Isaiah, especially among many who are also sick at our church, that the Lord will be with his soul, his spirit, to be courageous. Whatever the result is, that the Lord will touch that liver and that touch the organs of his body, and that he will bring him back to us in health. So let's pray, and then we'll look to God's word today. Sovereign and gracious and loving Heavenly Father God, we thank you so much, for you are the Lord of life and death. We praise you for your servants, especially we, on behalf of my brothers and sisters here, we lift up Pastor Isaiah to you. As his name bears, and as the word of God, of which we will look into today, that he will be a man of that knows salvation belongs to you. And that, Father, you may touch his body, which whatever ailment that is oppressing his body now, I pray you will give him peace even through suffering. And that, Father, we ask that through this examination, that if it be your will, Lord, and we ask that you will bring a healing touch to him, that, Father, his liver will be wiped clean of whatever is causing that problem and that pain. Would you identify to the hands of the doctors the wisdom, Lord, to discern what is wrong? And Lord, that you might bring him back to us with the testimony of your glory and your grace. We thank you so much for your sovereignty over our life, and hold him now as he worships with you, as he walks with you, as he is alone, away from his family and his newborn son and daughter. Lord, would you fill that loneliness with you? We thank you. We worship you today. So you look into your word. Lord, give us insight. Give us, Lord, the powerful conviction of your Holy Spirit, that we might not compromise the truth or, Lord, try and make it palpable for our own good, but we might receive it for what it is, and we might eat of it and bear much fruit today. We pray that we might know the second time, the second chance, and the third and the fourth and etc. that you give us every day. So may we give it unto you. May we give it unto your church. Lord, may we never give up for you, your kingdom, your church. We thank you. We worship you in Jesus' glorious, powerful, resurrected name we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. The word of the Lord today comes from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 11, verse 10 through 16. And this is our 21st step into the gospel according to Isaiah's visions. And we are closing out chapter 11 now. And this word at the end of chapter 11, as well as the entirety of this chapter, is a surprising word of hope. Of hope and deliverance through judgment, through a lifeless stump, that God would raise the great hope of a stem, a rod, a little shoot of a plant, an unmatured branch that would ever so grow delicately and grow out of this lifeless stump, this lifeless pavement, this brokenness in the nation, and sin in the nation. The living hope, of course, the branch and the root of Jesse, this is the living hope of Jesus Christ, who would gather his divided and dispersed people and would use the human line of Jesse and King David to come into existence. Remember, Jesus has no physical substance. He is God in eternity past, and he needed to choose a human line to come into the story of his creation. And if you can just imagine God, who subjects himself to biology and anatomy, to choose not royalty, to choose not the best genes, DNA in the world, but a broken man of God like Jesse, and a sinner as David was. We know him as a man of God's heart, but he also, as you know, was an adulterer, was a murderer. Likewise, a sinner like any one of us. But God chose, out of grace, this stump to grow his earthly life, to come into existence. The living hope of Jesus Christ, that he would gather his divided and dispersed people into a unity, giving them a second chance, giving them a second time to begin. And so the promised command of today's word is a second time from verse 11. I want you to turn to your neighbor again. Take a moment to pass this promise and this peace to them. Today, there is a second time for you. Can we say it to each other? Okay, turn to your neighbor and say, today, there is a second time for you. Amen and amen. You know, it is a rare thing that complete mastery and learning occurs the first time around. Rarely can anyone know anything at their first try. Rather, we all need to try it again and again. More than a few times. Many times over. The first time is rarely a perfect time. Instead, it takes practice. It takes setbacks. It takes multiples. It takes endurance. Easy things are first things. But the real worthwhile things of life, the valuable things, rarely come as first times. Like the first wobble steps of children, or the first words they learn to speak, or the first day of school, or for some of you, the first exam to take, or the first time to drive, or the first job to take, or the first year of marriage, or the first time parenting, or the first things never come easy. They're very, very difficult. First times demand second times. And so it is with life itself. We not only need a first try, right? But it requires a second chance. What life throws at you at times, the hardships that await you, both in the past, having in the past and in the future, if we are serious followers of Jesus Christ. There are hardships that await us, difficulties that overwhelm us. We all need a second time to face and to overcome. We need a second chance. And if we give up on the first time or transition out on the first try, we will never advance or grow to the second try. We will never advance to the second chance. If we end it all at the first time, it will end all at the first time. Yet if we open the heart to God's second time, we to try again, we can have another chance. We will experience the power to grow and be guided by growth outside of ourselves. We saw last week that this growth in us must be rooted in deep roots in our life. When the roots are properly grounded, then the fruits of our life can be properly uprooted. Roots hold the stability and the veins of life for any plant, keeping it alive. It takes 3.5 times more roots below the ground required to produce what comes above the ground. And the root is our source of life. We saw last week what that root was. This root is Jesus Christ himself, who came from a lifeless stump, a tree that was cut down by God's judgment on the arrogance of mankind. First growing out as a small shoot, a stem, a little rod coming out of Jesse, whom God used by his grace to bring about Jesus Christ into this physical world where both wolf and sheep gather and can be in harmony as the church of Jesus Christ. The word of God says, "There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, a branch from his roots shall bear fruit." Now, this is a small shoot. It seems that's growing out. It's seemingly insignificant stem that you and I would step over or pluck out. But God would be known and displayed in this kind of smallness, in this kind of humility of his own eternal Son, Jesus Christ, although he is the creator of the universe. That it would be encapsulated in the powerlessness of a child, of an infant. God's eternal Son, the message of this small stem, eternally rooted in eternity from the Father, is that his hand will extend again. That's the message of the gospel, is it not? That although all is wiped out and all is cut down, that there is a stem that will grow back, and that there is a second chance, a second time to recover, to restore, to reconcile, to build. God's hand will extend again to give a second time to his people. So my plea to all of you today is, do not give up on the first time. Can we say amen to that? Do not give up on the first time, whichever the Holy Spirit directs in your heart. The first time, do not give up on that time, but continue to God's second time. The gospel is that the message of is a message of the second time. So don't give up. Don't just transition out. Oh, there's nothing for me here, or there's too much hurt here, or you know what, this is not for me. Don't fade out or give reasons for a way out, but try again. Can we say amen to that? Try again. Said to my small little Jonah and Joy, when they were trying to walk, try again. Lift them up, try again. Come on, you could do it, try again. We all need that in this church, especially what has happened in light of the past months. We can try again, and we can build up God's kingdom and right the wrongs and bring a godly solution to the problem at hand. Can we say amen to that? There's always a new beginning. Always a new beginning in Christ, despite the past. So live in covenant over what is compatible. Live with the cross and not on a couch. Go for the second time. So let me give you today's central truth. In Jesus Christ, there is always a second time. There's always a new beginning. This arrives by inquiring. Everyone say inquire. Inquiring the Lord. And what is that? To gather. Everyone say gather. Who gathers his people in conflict towards correction. Everyone say correction. So that together they may walk across his highway. Everyone say highway. Highway that destroys the enemy of dispersion and division. Let's look at three lessons today to embrace living into a second time over the first time. Let's see how Jesus' gift of a second chance is not to give up at the first try, but a call to persevere to another try, to another try, to another try, especially as it relates to the church, especially. And how we are to press on instead of walk away from conflict. Before we throw in the towel and move forward or transition out, especially in the family of God's house, remember the gospel of second chances today. So let's look at our first lesson. That is to inquire Jesus Christ. Everyone say inquire. Inquire Jesus Christ, our common second chance to recovery, who gathers. Everyone say gathers. Gathers over disperses. Look with me to verse 10 through 12. The word of the Lord says, in that day, the root of Jesse, who shall stand and shall be, another word here is banner or signal for the peoples, of him shall the nations now all come together and inquire, which they didn't do beforehand, did they? And he shall be like a resting place that will be glorious. In that day when the Lord Jesus rules fully and finally, he will extend his hand yet a second time to recover the remnant that remains of his people. From where? From Assyria, from Egypt, from Pathros, from Cush, from Elam, from Shinar, from Hamath. and from the coastlands of the sea. And he will raise a signal for the nations, and they will gather, they will assemble the banished of Israel and gather the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. Now, what is happening here? I want to ask here, where is our power to give another second chance to recovery? That is the focus of this passage. It is focusing on our common rescue, Jesus Christ, to inquire on him, to seek his counsel of nations that once never did it. When he appears, they shall come together to inquire him. His wisdom that only happens when they assemble together. The entire gathering of the body. That is the focus of this passage. That when this root finally comes to fruition, that the nations will gather, that they will recover, and that they will assemble and never be dispersed again. See, problems begin to occur when our focus comes off of what is common to that which is compatible. So as long as we put our focus not on what is compatible according to the problem, but on what is our common rescue, that is our love in Jesus Christ for us and for each other. The cross of Jesus Christ, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, the gospel of Jesus Christ. No conflict can bear and settle on that. Can we say amen to that? We see here that Isaiah is continuing the message of living in Jesus, the branch from the stump of Jesse, that in that day, Jesus Christ will fully reign and rule. And he shall stand as a banner, it says, as a rallying point, a signal. I'm here. So now it's time to put aside your differences, your idols. It's time to come and inquire of me. Of him shall the nations gather to inquire, to seek after, to hunger after, to know. And his resting place shall be glorious. In other words, yes, we will all be together at the last day when we'll all get to heaven, as the hymn says, yes. But that implies that you and I should all seek to be together on this earth as much as it will be in heaven on that day. Can we say amen to that? When Jesus Christ will signal, before he signals, in that final day, signaling to us through the cross, as he is high and lifted up, he says, when I am lifted up, I will draw all men to myself. We'll all get to heaven, but that also means today we must all be together on earth. And the key here, as we have sought and found, especially at our retreat, the key here is Jesus. The key here is Jesus. If Jesus is the center, when we lose the center, we lose the stability. Even with the signal of Jesus, we inquire other ways without the body, without the entire body. I want to take a moment here to sincerely thank everyone who has been here for the past many months at this church and who's held the line of sound judgment in the Lord. And we were able to examine what was happening from a holistic viewpoint. And we came to the conclusion that God is not done with this church, nor any other church. Can we say amen to that? And that you and I are here today because it is not so much time to transition out, nor is it time to forfeit the covenants that we make before the Lord. But it is time, like by way of a lifeless stump when Jesus Christ appeared, that the stem is growing from the branch of Jesse to signal to you and me to rally his people together. That is God's heart. That is what grieves God's heart. Nothing more when God's people are dispersed in division. To signal and rally God's people together. To inquire of the Lord together. To recover his remnant and what remains of his people. Look at verse 11 with me. His hand will extend now, not in anger as we saw back in chapter 10 in the past, but in grace to give us second chance to recovery for his people. And look at the nations listed here. This cannot be a fulfillment that Isaiah was thinking about in the near future of that time. This cannot be the post-exilic return of God's people after they've been exiled from Babylon. Because there's many other nations that are listed here that God's going to gather, it says. All sorts of people from the farthest places. It says the coastlands of the sea that the Lord will gather to recover. And this is the first step to recovery, my brothers and sisters, to our common second chance to recover. No matter how far we've fallen, no matter where we come from, no matter what we've done, no matter who we were. Verse 12, the Lord will banish. He will banish and gather the dispersed from the four corners of the earth. And this second time of recovery alludes, of course, to this second exodus of God's people. Not only what we see in the book of Exodus, the story of Israel coming out of the hands of Egyptian slavery, but also the dispersion of God's people in conflict, in division. Israel, Judah to the south, and all the four corners of the earth to come together because of the signal of who Jesus Christ is. Let's review this point. I want to ask you, where are you seeking? Where are you inquiring today? Inquiring means to seek. Inquire means to hunger after. Today, what first time have we left, leaving powerless the Lord's second time, leaving only dispersion, leaving only defeat, leaving only division? I plead with you and me today, inquire Jesus Christ. Can we say amen to that? Inquire Jesus Christ. What is the heart of Jesus Christ for the sake of the body of Christ? Your second chance. Your third chance, your fourth chance. Some of us need to give a second chance to a relationship. Some of us need to give a second chance to your marriage. Some of us need to give a second chance to your studies, a second chance to your church. This beloved church, Bethany family. But it all starts from what is common, not complementary. What is common? Don't seek what is complementary, but what is common. It's the same Jesus, the same grace, the same resurrection, the same love that we all need to gather and to grow in it and to recover through it. Can we say amen to that? And that is my heart, as I always watch my heart. If there's anything that might divide me, especially from anyone in this church, especially our beloved Korean congregation, that Lord, help me to come back to the common ground in you. You have created this special church for that reason. Our second lesson today is that a second chance to recovery is not born by conflict. Everyone say conflict. But correction. Everyone say correction. Correction to be together. Everyone say together. Together in the Lord. Look with me to verse 13 through 14. Now, Isaiah describes the conflict between the north and the south. Nothing new, right? From the past 10 chapters, 11 chapters. The jealousy of Ephraim, that is another reference to Israel in the north, shall depart. Those who harass Judah in the south shall be cut off. Ephraim shall not be jealous of Judah. Judah shall not harass Ephraim. But they now, one group now, they shall sweep down on the shoulder of their enemies, the Philistines in the west, and together they shall plunder the people of the east. They shall put out of their hand against Edom and Moab, the Ammonites and the Ammonites, all these sworn enemies of God's people in the Old Testament, shall obey them. Here, there was internal strife, long going conflict among God's people after the last king of the United Kingdom, King Solomon. And because of King Solomon's taxations to the north and his big building projects, that, and also conflict in pride and desire for power, this once United Kingdom split in half. Israel, or Ephraim, termed here, to the north, and Judah to the south. They couldn't get along. They set up their own capitals. They set up their own temples. Which temple to worship in the north, or is it Jerusalem in the south? And they split in half. They couldn't find their common ground in the grace of God, in the provision and the leading of the Lord their God. It was literally brother against brother, sister against sister, dividing against each other, jealousy, harassment, tribal allegiance, pride. Yet what was God's solution here? That's what's important. Okay, there's the problem. There's the problem. So now with the problem, what's the solution then? Does God say, okay, Ephraim, just do your own thing. Judah, you can go your own way. No. Move on from each other and just make amicable peace. No, the Lord says, what does he do? He makes these divisions depart. He makes what is separating them cut off. And then he corrects their conflict so that they may together again. Verse 14. They may together again. Look at verse 14. That they may together again as one body, one church, one people again. And here as Presbyterians and as Reformed theologians, we believe there's one people of God. Here, as we look into this scripture, it is a foreshadow and a portrait of the church of Jesus Christ, that they should together be a people again. Now, instead of being geographically apart or spiritually torn apart or being enemies, they now will be one and turn towards battling their real enemy together. Stoop down together to the shoulders of the Philistines, it says, and they shall put out of their hand against their enemies, the sworn enemies of God's people, the Edomites, the Moabites, the Ammonites. So instead of conflict among themselves, they're able to birth a second chance by correction to come together as a reconciled body, and God's people redirect their battle against their common enemy and the gain that they all benefit being the promise of God. But this is all born out of correction. So let me review this point today. We can only give a second chance when we are teachable. Let me repeat that again. We can only give a second chance when we are teachable and humble enough in the Lord to be corrected. Nothing is born out of conflict. Nothing of God's hand is born out of conflict. No work of God is born out of division. As is here, God first corrects, then he unifies his people. Then the battle is fought. We can't fight divided. So my plea to all of us today is that we receive correction and not just desire compassion. Yes, we all want grace. We all want gentleness. And that is my weakness too. We all want to be recognized and not have ourselves be in the wrong. But we need to deal with the authority of God's word. We need to deal with what's happened, no matter what our intentions were, especially at what has happened in and through our lives. What constitutes division? What justifies moving on? What justifies walking out without proper knowledge, without proper commissioning, without proper blessing and send-off among ourselves? God does not birth anything through conflict, but correction. So let's stay in that posture of correction before the Word of God. We read in our retreat the entire four chapters of 2 Timothy. And in chapter 3, it says, all scripture is breathed out by God and is profitable for teaching, for reproof or rebuke, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, and woman of God, complete, equipped for every good work. We don't like correction. We like being correctors. Yet we'll forfeit the second chance God has in store to pour out. So today, in humility, let us be corrected. Let us be truthful. And my last point is to bring a second time to recovery, the Lord destroys. Everyone say destroys. Destroys the real enemy to pave his highway. Everyone say highway. Highway for us to walk across in unity. Look with me to verse 16. The Lord will utterly destroy the tongue of the Sea of Egypt and will wave his hand over the river with his scorching breath and strike it into seven channels as he will lead people across in sandals. And verse 16, there will be a highway from Assyria for the remnant that remains of his people, as there was for Israel when they came up from the land of Egypt. So here, the Lord will now utterly destroy the real enemy. And that's not one another, but after correction, after unity and restoration, that he will bring the real power against our enemy, whereby God's people are now unified against who they should be. They will claim victory and salvation as God's ancient people did when they came out of the land of Egypt. Look at this allusion to, we all know the story of Moses splitting the Red Sea. Splitting the Red Sea so that God's people can walk across on dry ground. And here is the same allusion to what is going to happen when in Jesus Christ we claim victory through him and salvation, as God's people Israel did, came up from the land of Egypt, crossing the Red Sea on dry ground. We will all get there together. through a highway that God will pay for them, just as he opened up the sea for them to walk across. God will make a way for us to get across the sea of life, the endless sea of life. Can we say amen to that? He will pave the highway for us. So I want to review this point. A house divided cannot stand, as Jesus says. So also, if we flip it around as well, a house united cannot be stopped either. My question is your house united or is your house divided? Your family, the house of your family, the house of your church, the house of your community, and where God sends you in the spheres of influence. They didn't walk across the highway of God separately, right? They didn't walk across separately. Everyone together, it says. This prophecy is everyone together. Ephraim and Judah. Jew and Gentile. Korean, American and American Korean. Or whatever else. We will walk across together to the Lord. Let's continue to nurture that always with the second, with the third, with the fourth, with the fifth, and so on. Chance. Nothing to come between us and the Lord and each other. I want to close today by reviewing that we've seen throughout these first 11 chapters how the rebellions of one king, that's Ahaz, resulted in greater division and greater dispersion of God's people. But now, through the one righteousness of another king to come, that's Jesus Christ, who would bring revival and return of God's promises. Can we say amen to that? We are living in this second time. The Lord Jesus is giving you and me second time. Will we humble ourselves to take the second time and to step into that second time? A second time, a third time, a fourth time, a fifth, and another with him, inquiring of him, gathering together because of him, moving forward out of correction over conflict, walking across the way to Jesus Christ, hand in hand, destroying dispersion and division. I'm reminded of this scripture, Ephesians 4:3. The NLT translation says, make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together in peace. You know, I know we hear this kind of message over and over again, how important it is to be united in Jesus Christ, especially within our congregation here, especially with our relationship with our Korean congregation family. That whichever the struggles are, to give a second, a third, a fourth, a fifth chance. It really can't be said enough. Relating to every sphere of our life, not only the church. So as it depends on us, let us sow into unity, especially our families, our marriage to this precious, beloved church, Bethany, keeping our covenant, being faithful, so as long as it depends on us, making every effort to live into God's second chance. Because he gave us another chance, did he not? From death to life, through Jesus Christ, who the shoot that was coming out of this lifeless ground, who came up and bore our guilt, our shame, our first time, so that we can have another time. When then? Why then can we not give another time to the Lord and to each other? Let us be careful to ever close that window So as long as it depends on you and me, let us live into the second time. Can we say amen to that? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for your words today. I pray your spirit might take that and bring it to fruition in your way, O Lord. And as we now close with praise and go into our lunch and sharing, I pray that we will share this word. And Lord, build this type of second chance life together. We praise you, we thank you, we worship you for the honor to be part of this family. We praise you, we glorify you. In Jesus' glorious name we pray. All God's people said, amen and amen. Let us all stand in honor to the Lord if we are able. As we close in prayer.
But now they'd fall. But you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You've never failed. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. I've seen you move the mountains, and I believe I'll see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and I believe I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move the mountains, and I believe I see you do it again. You made a way when there was no way, and And I believe I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do it again. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never failed me yet. You never failed me yet. I never will forget. You never failed me yet. I never will forget.
You have never failed us yet, Lord. God forbid that we should ever forget. You are the Lord of this church. You are the Lord of our families. You are the Lord of all the brokenness. Lord, you have the ability to extend out your hand for a second time and to restore all that was lost, to rebuild all, Lord, that was broken. Help us never lose the sight of the gospel in our lives, wherever you send us now. That, Lord, especially in this church, in this beloved church, that your work will continue and you will use us as we continue to assemble, continue to gather, continue to reconcile, continue, Lord, to be the church of Jesus Christ. Now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the great loving kindness of God our Father and the true fellowship that unites us as one body, as one united community, family, under you, Lord, be with you, God's people, God of second chances, now and forevermore. All God's people said, amen and amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. Please join us for our lunch and sharing as we divide into brothers and sisters in the corner room and the fellowship room. We have food for you. Okay, so please join us. God bless your week.